So as you might recall, the most common and the most damning complaint about Jesse Eisenberg's version of Lex Luthor was that he's not like the comic, right? And perhaps the most fatal flaw that both Zack Snyder and Chris Terrio made when it came to the character, and to some degree Jesse Eisenberg, because he's culpable, because he brought Luthor to life on the big screen, is that they didn't make it clear that they had reimagined Lex Luthor as a millennial, right? Think like Mike Ross on Suits, full of entitlement and having no respect for tradition or his elders, right? And when you think of Lex Luthor in that regard, it does start to make a little bit more sense. But instead, a lot of fans held out hope that the references to Lex Luthor's father meant that a true Lex Luthor existed out there somewhere. The reality of the situation is that Lex Luthor has always been a junior, so they were just following continuity there. But now when it comes to Suicide Squad, David Ayer has also reimagined two iconic DC villains, the Joker and Harley Quinn. And in fact, he's made even more changes than we thought, as evidenced by new information that was revealed last week in the Entertainment Weekly coverage. Not a lot of information came out there. The movie's only 3 weeks away or so, but still some surprising changes have been made to the mythology. And I find it fascinating that people are okay with that. And I think it has a lot to do with the sex appeal of the two characters. So, they should have maybe cast a more attractive actor, traditionally attractive actor than Jesse Eisenberg. And perhaps he might want to use the gym equipment and at prison. Although, of course, as we know from the Ultimate Edition cut, he went to Arkham. So will he pop up in Suicide Squad? Who knows? But anyway, today I want to get out in front of the changes so that we can go into Suicide Squad fully understanding what David Ayer has reimagined, so maybe we're a little bit more open to it. Also, they did a very good job of kind of like shocking us early on with that very first reveal of the Joker so that we had time to transition and to accept it. And so now that the movie's coming, we feel all a lot better about it. Although, let's see how we feel after we've seen the performance. And Heath Ledger, by the way, was also very different from the comics, but there was still a little bit of that gangster, mobster vibe there. It was just the hipster version of it, right? Like Heath Ledger's Joker was the Dapper Dan, and Dapper Dans, of course, love the 1940s and 30s. That's the whole thing that they're referencing. So it's still kind of tied in. But anyway, David Ayer and Jared Leto's Joker is the most modern version of the character yet, and they've clearly, grounded him in the world of gangs, not only Latino gangs, but, to some degree also Russian gangs. But Latino gangs, big thing, obviously, in Los Angeles, where David Ayer has set almost all, I think actually all of his films, and covering that conflict between the law and those exact gangs, right? So it makes sense that that's where he would put all of his Suicide Squad characters to some degree, but the Joker would draw on what Ayer knows, right? You do what you know. But what's also interesting is that while this version of the character is very accessible to Ayer, he's also very accessible to you. This is the most accessible version of the Joker that they've ever made. He's just a guy who's dyed his hair green and put on red lipstick. No scars, no twisted mouth. And I think it's interesting that they've really created a character who's a guy on the small side when you think about it. Like, who would follow Jared Leto in prison, right, if he was just Jared Leto? But because he's using theatrics, sex appeal, and, being unpredictable, he's able to rise to power, which is a really interesting choice. And on that note, this is the most I think we've ever been able to see the Joker put two and two together inside his head. Like, we can see the thought process unfolding. Now, this Joker is still unpredictable, which is a vital aspect to the character. He is, after all, the wild card in the deck, right? But still, there are moments when he seems a little bit more lucid than any other Joker we've seen before. He can run a business. He does have a plan, and it's not an ironic one, where Heath Ledger was saying his whole agenda was to disrupt the plan. But here, this Joker is a businessman. As they said in the new Entertainment Weekly coverage, he owns a series of clubs where he has go-go dancers with Batman masks on. I think that's absolutely hilarious. But even this other behind-the-scenes footage that was revealed shows the Joker with a cell phone cover, right? The old, most Joker versions would never have a cell phone cover. He's not that responsible. If he had a cell phone at all, it would be horribly cracked and he'd probably give it to one of his henchmen to hold, right? So that's really, really interesting. But again, he's while he's more responsible and a little bit more of a thinking man's Joker, and again, someone that you could be, that anyone could more potentially be, he doesn't quite seem like the warped individual. You know, he seems more like an artist, like Andy Warhol, right? Like he just came up with this idea first. And it almost begs the question, you know, everyone always says the Batman is the one is the inspiration for his rogues gallery in Gotham, right? But maybe Joker was also inspirational as well, because he seems less unhinged and more brilliant. Like, wow, that is a very good high concept idea, Mr. Joker. But he also still has a sense of humor, which I appreciate. Like you can see here in this sequence, this behind the scenes clip, he's, you know, looking over something that's been acquired, and the way he pats it, you know, the case is, you know, it's humorous, but at the same time, he seems, again, very lucid, right? Like he has a plan, and also almost it's like an afterthought, like, oh yeah, I'm supposed to be funny and make fun of stuff. I better tack that on at the end. But first, I wanted to make sure that I had it. You know, he's responsible first, which is fascinating. But then the biggest change, and I was really surprised to see this in the Entertainment Weekly coverage, is that this Joker loves Harley. He's never loved Harley before, ever. In the comics, he manipulated her, I think because he could, and because, you know, he saw an opportunity present itself, and who doesn't like to take advantage of an opportunity, especially when you have nothing else to do in Arkham. But also he wanted to have an ace up his sleeve. It was a power move, and you know, you never know when you might need one of the Arkham psychiatrists in your back pocket. But then he found it hilarious, as you might recall, on the Mad Love story and the animated adaptation on the series, that she went with it, right? I mean, I think that's why he laughs so hard when she breaks him out of Arkham, because he never imagined it would take the way that it did. But then, infamously, or famously, for those of us who love the Joker and Harley, and who doesn't, she wouldn't go away. And so that's a big part of their relationship. But sometimes he sees her as being useful, but she's just very cloying. And at the end of the day, the Joker doesn't love anyone as much as he loves Batman. That's something that Scott Snyder, well, Grant Morrison to some degree, but Scott Snyder really, really doubled down on. And it's a very big part of the Joker's mythology, that Batman is who he sees as his equal. Because I don't see any Harley tattoos on the Joker, do you? He has the knife going through, and you can get, see in this photo a great look at his tattoos. He has a knife going through the bat symbol, and then also he has what looks to be a dead robin on his other arm, which is pretty awesome, actually. I've really come to like the tattoos. I wouldn't have liked them if they went with David Ayer's original idea, which apparently was that Harley doodled on him with a Sharpie when he was out of it, quote-unquote, either of his own doing or, you know, from Arkham medication. But I don't like that. I think that they have to be very careful. We'll talk about this more in a moment, about how much Harley defines the Joker. He's supposed to be in charge. He created her. And I think that's a very important part of the dynamic between the two. And Ayer doesn't seem to feel the same way. But anyway, I'm glad they're his own, the tattoos he put on himself. I would hate to have someone else write damaged across his forehead. That would be not so good. But you know, this again is very reminiscent of the tattoos that gang leaders get, or just any gang member would get in prison. And so it also shows his accomplishments, right? So I think it's great, and I love his infatuation with Batman. He is supposed to be the only one that Joker feels is worthy of him, right? Although in this new incarnation, it seems that Harley is also his equal, because they've said that the premise is that the Joker wants Harley back. You know, he's lost, I think to some degree, his favorite toy, or he's actually in love with her. Margot Robbie has confirmed that Harley Quinn is still very much in love with the Joker. And that's very, very interesting, because Ayer basically has turned them into Gotham's Bonnie and Clyde, Sid and Nancy, Mickey and Mallory from Natural Born Killers. Which to some degree makes total sense for someone who's approaching the material from the outside. And by that I mean not a comic book fan, hasn't read these characters from the, like from their beginnings to some degree, hasn't seen them more, seen them, you know, grow and evolve, I guess is the right word. Ayer's coming out at this as a filmmaker and a storyteller's perspective for sure, but you know, with his own background, what interests him, and also what's been popular in movies. Bonnie and Clyde, Warren Beatty and Faye Dunaway, are one of the most popular movie couples of all time. Bonnie and Clyde themselves captivated, the world with the media coverage of their exploits exploits in real life. So to try and base Joker and Harley on them makes total sense. But it doesn't make total sense, you know, from the outside perspective. And that's what I've said from the very beginning with these adaptations, you know, with Julie Taymor in Spider-Man, with Chris Terrio in Batman v Superman. To see these people come from not being fans and interpret the material is fascinating, to see how they see it, right? You're like, wow, you see it totally different than everyone who loves comics does. And I think that's one of the reasons that I've been a little bit more open, and some of you have also been more open to the changes that were made. But still, it doesn't work, because the problem is that Paul Dini created Harley Quinn as an example of abuse, right? And that's really what she's supposed to stand for. So David Ayer has taken a character that was the poster woman for abuse and now has made her a poster woman for female empowerment. And she never even got to evolve to that point as she has in the comics over the years. She just starts out that way. So a number of people will meet Harley Quinn and just see her as the female version of the Joker. They had a really, I think, I have to censor it a little bit. The costume department apparently is female-centric on Suicide Squad. And they looked at Harley as her mantra being, people like you, meaning the Joker, need to F people like me, meaning Harley. And that's real groupie talk, by the way, but I've never seen Harley talk that way to the Joker, and it's very hard for me as a Harley Quinn fan from the beginning to wrap my head around that. But anyway, I think another problem that they have, and one of the reasons that the Joker might be so attracted to Harley and actually genuinely love her, is that they actually went and made Harley much sexier than she's ever been in the comics. Now, I'm sure some of you will be like, what are you talking about? Harley's always been attractive. And the video games are partially responsible for this too. But she's never been as sexy as this latest version of the character. And I feel that's going to be problematic if they ever bring Poison Ivy on the scene as well, because Poison Ivy's supposed to be the sexiest, but now I think it would be very hard to compete with Margot Robbie's Harley Quinn. So, you know, I think to some degree you look at Margot Robbie's Harley Quinn and go, who wouldn't be in love with that, right? Or have at least some nice feelings towards her. And that's a little bit of a problem they've created for themselves. But, you know, the Joker still is not supposed to love anyone more than himself and Batman, no matter how hot they might be. Now, as for Harley, they not only made her hotter, but they made her smarter. They talked about, now deep down, I have in my notes here that Harley Quinn has always been smart to some degree, because she was a psychiatrist, but it's important to remember that Paul Dini and Bruce Timm and Mad Love went out of their way to say that she didn't quite earn her degree, that she slept with a couple of professors to get it because, you know, she was interested in writing a tell-all book, because she didn't quite make it in the world of gymnastics after all, and they have kept that, Margot Robbie says. She still has a gymnast background, but that's why she decided to be a psychiatrist at Arkham, to become a famous, you know, doctor, so to speak. But so she's actually not that good at her job, right? But they're saying here that they've kind of turned her into a Hannibal Lecter type character, that she's at Arkham as well as the Joker, not at Belrive Prison. And she has a very special cell that's been made for her, you know, this birdcage cell, and that the guards have to be rotated to keep Harley Quinn from warping any of their minds and turning them to her side. Isn't that fascinating? Because that's what was done to her. The Joker warped her mind and turned her to his side. Now, you could say maybe she was like, that worked out swell, why don't I try it? But it's really weird to see someone who was the manipulatee become the manipulator. And in this recent coverage, they made quite a point of Ayer telling Robbie during rehearsals that whenever she saw a character display any type of weakness, you know, particularly personally, that she should pounce on it. Like Margot Robbie said, like a scorpion's tail, and just, you know, immediately use that to her advantage. And that's a very different version of the character than we've ever seen. Also, is her jail cell at Arkham going to be cooler than the Joker's? When you make Joker and Harley at the same level, you open up the door to the potential of Harley surpassing her teacher. And I think that would be very dangerous indeed. And interestingly enough, I have to say, I think these characters, though, are at their weakest when they try to imitate the iconic poses from the comics. I think that they just need to embrace that they're something totally different, and we'll see if audiences embrace it as well. But anyway, so they've taken Harley Quinn and they've made her a very smart alpha female instead of, again, you know, an example of abuse in relationships. And that's to some degree the danger of girl power when you have these people telling these stories in a different medium, so interested in pushing the, you know, the girl power agenda, that they kind of forget like not only the original point of the character, but how she fits into the larger story as a whole. So anyway, the flirtation with Deadshot still seems to be intact, or maybe Harley's just manipulating him as well, but she might be manipulating him in the comics too. So I'm curious, what do you think of these changes to the Joker and Harley Quinn? And also, if you're okay with them, why are you okay with them, but not okay with the changes they made to Jesse Eisenberg's Lex Luthor? I think that the real answer here is sex appeal. I think, well, better explained, better grounded in the story. I think they tried to do so much in Batman v Superman that they couldn't really get every idea across fully explain it. But Suicide Squad seems smaller in scope. And I think David Ayer also has put all of his characters in the same boat, so it's a little bit easier to flesh them out. Also, David Ayer has perpetuated these kind of characterizations so much in his own movies that audiences are already very familiar with them. Whereas the millennial, while joked about a lot, is not very well defined in entertainment still. But I'm curious, what do you think? Your thoughts on this? I'm very excited to discuss it with you down below, and you can check out some other episodes right now.